Our second speaker is going to deal with the topic of protection of female domestic migrant workers, role of the law. And our speaker is senior lecturer, M.A.D.S.J.S. Niriella, head of the Department of Public and International Law, Faculty of Law, University of Columbia. She has published many research articles in referred international and local journal publications and has presented many research papers at international and national conferences hosted by international research organizations, universities, and other academic institutions. Her specialties and interests in her research areas are criminal law and justice, law of evidence and criminal procedure, human rights, international law, and gender issues.
Thank you, Chair. Good morning to you all. On the chairperson, the presentation, and my fellow presenters, the distinguished members, invitees, and all the audience. Today, my presentation is the protection of the female domestic migrant workers, the role of the law. Before I start my presentation, let me to brief you the compelling reasons behind me to undertake this piece of work. Because normally all my presentations and presentations are based on criminal law and criminal justice. And after a long time, after I did my the public law domain lecture at the conference in 2008, thereafter this is after a long time, wanted to do another area of public law to show you small but very burning issue in the country and what the law can do relating to minimize and overcome these issues for the betterment of the women, you and me and other persons in the country. So then the compelling reasons are when I research in last year relating to juvenile delinquency, one of the research findings was I saw that reason for the juvenile delinquency is the mothers who are going to abroad as domestic workers. So then I presented that my presentation and I saw that when I took the postal belt of the country, especially the western part, I saw that how many the semi-urban sector women are going abroad to earn money, and Sri Lanka, when at the high tone, we say that our women are bringing foreign inflow at a high level. So, but we did not look at so far the sad and the stories behind that, how these people are suffering and undergrowth. So that is the very first reason compelled me to undertake this research. The second thing is, being as a woman, I thought that what I can do, being as a person who is headed by this public law department in the faculty, what can I do for the betterment of the women in the country, like you and me? The third one, the connectivity of the today's that is the development. So then, this is clearly related to the economic development of the country. So the outline is first the background, then the research problem, main arguments for the hypothesis, then the objective, methodologies, discussion that includes the theoretical framework of this work and the research findings. Finally, the forum is open to you to ask questions. So if I just go the background. Over the years, you know that foreign employment has generated significant inflows of the remittances and paid as a safety control device for local unemployment. This is common to Sri Lanka and other South region countries. However, female migrant domestic workers are more vulnerable for various forms of abuse than any other migrant workers, such as male, female, especially professional migrant in-laws. If we just go further beyond, we can see physical and mental abuse, sexual harassment, rape, physical torture that leads to disability, or even death are common criminal offenses which committed against them by their foreign employees. Religious and cultural discrimination, lack of freedom of movement, association and expression, social stigma, and unequal economic treatment are some of the victimizations that they have faced during the period of their employment in other countries, not like their motherland. So therefore, the law should be able to provide complete protection for the female domestic migrant workers. This is what I want to focus today as the role of the law. So therefore, my research problem is why the female domestic migrant workers are still more vulnerable for various forms of abuse. So this is my argument. My argument of the hypothesis is that gap between the international standards and the national laws is one of the reasons, among other socio-economic, cultural, political reasons for this unsafe situation. So, I intend to critically evaluate the existing national laws relating to female domestic migrant workers in order to provide a complete protection for these women, special reference to Sri Lanka. The methodology, because of the time constraints, I do not want to elaborate this. I did the research, history and field research in order to prove my case. So then the discussion, this includes the theoretical framework as well as the research findings. So if you take the Sri Lankan scenario, the International Convention on Civil and Political Rights, that is ICESCR, and CEDR, NCW, and CEDAW, these are the main conventions that specifically focus on this issue at the international arena. So then Sri Lanka also has ratified all the international conventions on the protection of the rights of all migrant workers and members of the families, that is CMW in 1995. That is the most significant international convention really focused on this area. So then, in addition to that, Sri Lanka ratified 7, here I mentioned including CMW, all together, 8 fundamental conventions, 2 government conventions, and 30 technical conventions of the ILO. And out of these 40 conventions, Sri Lanka ratified of 31 are now in force, and 9 conventions have been denounced later on. Sri Lanka has now endorsed the ILO multilateral framework on labour migration as well. So then, please let me say in brief, what are the basic standards protected by these international conventions? These are the non-discrimination and equal protection. In addition to that, there are some other core principles, that is the right to mobility, right to economic development are also protected by these international standards. So in addition to that, some other protective standards are there, that is mostly relating to their economic development and the protection. So then, when it comes to Sri Lanka's situation, Sri Lanka, in addition to all the ratification and being a member of all these conventions, we have a very significant act which governs all the laws relating to these domestic workers. Okay. That is Sri Lankan Bureau of Foreign Employment Act No. 21 of 1985. That is the main legislative enactment that was enacted in 1985. Thereafter, the 2 amendments were introduced, respectively 1994 as well as 2009. Then, the Sri Lanka Bureau of Foreign Employment, the main regulatory body for the labour migration, was established under this Act with a long-term objectives and responsibilities to develop and manage the entire industry. That is why I said at the beginning, this relates to the development. So development, if you want to develop something, you have to look at the responsibility that we have to really protect the people who are involved in whatever the industry or that arena. So then, the main legislation that we have to protect these people who are going abroad and bringing a lot of foreign currency to the country. So then, as I said that in this my small piece of study, I found that there are many gaps between the international standards which I mentioned in the past and the Sri Lankan standards. So then, the number one is undertake the welfare protection of Sri Lankan employee outside Sri Lanka, and that's the one of the main objectives of SLP